My name is Vaichi Tso, part of Elite Mastermind Group. Thank you for being here this morning. Go ahead and introduce yourself to everybody. I mean, everybody knows who you are, man. But again, just go. I mean, if they don't know you, they need to definitely know you. So
I know.
go ahead and introduce yourself. Let us know where you're tuning in from.
For sure. Well, I appreciate the kind words. My name is Torrence Hampton. I am the co-founder, executive producer, creative director of Dream Factor Films, and also the creator of the Genius Factor Academy. I'm tuning in from the East Coast in Richmond, Virginia today, man. And thank you for having me, dude. I'm glad to be here. So I'm looking
Man,
forward.
you're on the other side of the Mississippi River. It's all good.
Yes.
It's all good.
It's all good. It's
It's
all
all
good.
good. It's
It's
all
all
good.
good.
Let's dive into it. I got
Let's
a lot
go.
of questions.
Let's go.
Tell me about three elements that help an entrepreneur become an entrepreneur. And I know you got a whole entire program. We talked about it the other day, the
Yep.
eight elements. I mean, we're going to go through all that, but I don't think we're going to have enough time. But give me the top three things as an entrepreneur, if they're watching this live session or replay or whatever, three key elements that could help them take their business to just next level, not to $1 billion, just to the next level.
Yes, so I got you. Three. First off, self-awareness. Self-awareness is number one. Self-awareness is number one because I don't think we spend enough time on that. And I think it's critically important because you have to know that self. And I reason that I think it's important because when you have a heightened sense of self-awareness, it allows you to turn the noise down around you. Don't worry about the judgment of what other people say, and know that you're making a decision that's based on what you know is true in your heart and aligns with your passion. Number two would be you have to have passion about what you do. If you're not passionate about what you're doing, it won't work because it's too hard. You know this. It's too hard to run a business. And when it gets hard, you're gonna quit unless you truly love it. So your passion factor, your passion meter, or what I call your genius factor, has to be on 1,000. So that's always got to be there. And then the other piece, there are two. You said three, but I'm gonna give you four. Number three would be you have to find a way to monetize yourself and properly capitalize your business. Cash flow is king, man, in any business. So you got to always be thinking about how can I make multiple streams of revenue? Because look, right now we're in the middle of a global pandemic. Your primary business isn't making money. So you got to have the secondary or third layer to your business. So it being able to pivot and be proactive and looking at multiple streams of revenue. And then the last is grit. You gotta have grit. And I don't think you can get that by going to business school. And I have friends and colleagues that argue back and forth, go to business school, get an MBA from Harvard or Columbia. I think that's okay for some people.
It's good for networking. It's good
It
for
is.
networking.
It's good
It
for
puts you in the
networking.
right circle of the elite because if your buddies are multimillionaires or their parents are multimillionaires, the transactional activity that's going to happen, or the little tips that they give you here and there,
Yes.
they're opening a startup. They call you up. They're like, "Hey, we want you to sit on the board. We want you to do the marketing." So you need to have that elite. But do you need to go to that school to build that, connections? That's
No.
questionable.
Yeah,
I don't
well,
think so, in my opinion, but.
I agree. So you're right. So what you're talking about is network. Network is exponentially important. And that is the only value I see about going to Harvard or Columbia or Wharton. Going to just get the degree, in my mind, is a waste of time because you still need to go out and get real world experience. And number four was grit. They won't teach you grit by learning theory by reading out of a book in a classroom. Won't happen. I believe entrepreneurship is a full contact sport like basketball, right? So if you're not playing, you're not in it. If you're not trying to build a business from the ground up and actually doing it, it's kind of like going to school and saying, I'm going to get a degree in basketball, a master's, but you've never touched the ball before. That wouldn't work, right? So you actually have to go and do it. You got to shoot, you got to practice. So as an entrepreneur, you got to practice. So those are my four.
No, definitely. I agree with that 100%. So here's my question. Would this principle hold true? If I am passionate about something, let's say I'm passionate about music,
Yep.
I move to my parents' house, I get rid of my car, I get rid of all my accessories. Instead of having an iPhone 11, I go
Yep.
buy an iPhone 6. I get rid of all of that fancy stuff that I got, right?
Yep.
Everything, bring my cost of living down to like $500 a month, where I
Yes.
could make it very easily work at a pizza, Domino's, Uber, do whatever. 500, that's all I need for my livelihood. Then can I go pursue my passion and don't have a cash flow to build a name and build myself that stamina that I need, the skills, the wisdom, the experience that I need, so one day I could make a lot of money from my passion? Because as a business owner, you need to have cash flow, but how much of cash flow? If I need 10,000, then I might sacrifice a lot of things in the process. But if I only need $500 to survive, or if I need $1,000 to survive, that's very, I can hit that very easily per month and still be in positive instead of red. It's sometimes, you know, that's what I was thinking for a lot of the younger brand new entrepreneurs. They should hold a job. Meanwhile, they're working on their passion. The minute their passion is paying enough as the same as their job, now they could replace that.
100%. I agree with that 100%. You should take an average job just to pay your bills, minimize your expense. Everything you said is right while you're pursuing your passion, and then figure out a way how to monetize your passion. That's the whole idea behind my platform, Make Your Passion Your Paycheck, right? So what I teach in my course is we focus on heightened sense of self-awareness. We then identify your talents, your natural God-given talents, and your passion, and map that to what I call genius factor. There are 9 different genius factor categories: musical, athletic, visual, numbers, so on and so forth. So if you're a musician and you have musical genius, you should be focusing on jobs, internships, mentors, anything, starting a business in the music industry, period. You shouldn't be going to law school unless you want to be an attorney for musicians, right? So it's got to match your passion. So I agree with that 100%. You should never focus on money, right? Your money will find you. Focus on your passion, figure out a way to monetize a passion, and then be patient. The problem with young kids, they're not patient. So that's why they want to go and get a BMW and go get the iPhone 15 and just buy all the stuff that they really don't need just for show, to try to show off for people that don't care about them anyway. It just doesn't make any sense. So you're right.
I mean, listen, if you're going to be a podcaster or somebody who's going to do a lot of IGTV and you're creating content, and if you tell me you're going to go buy that phone, I understand. That makes sense, you know? But other than that, I see your point. So why not make your passion your fortune?
Yeah, well, you can make your passion your fortune, right? That's fine. Passion your paycheck, passion your fortune, either one. My goal is my vision is I want to inspire everyone to discover their genius. I believe everyone's a genius. You're a genius. I'm a genius. All 8 billion people on the planet have genius level talent. The key is your genius.
You're saying that because your mom told you that? Because my mom always tells me I'm a genius, but then my wife sometimes shakes her head. So I don't know. There's a conflict between my mom and my wife. So they always have this idea. My mom thinks I'm genius and I can do everything. And I love her for that. Yes. You know, she never says you're low IQ, this, that, don't do this. She always did. But my wife, just the way she looks at me, tells me she has doubts about that genius a lot of times. So are you saying that because your loved one said that to you, or you mean that?
No, I mean it because it's true. And your mom and your wife, they may both be right in certain elements, right? So we're gonna leave that alone. But here, my ultimate overarching macro thought is, everyone has genius level talent. Everyone has something they're passionate about. The difference is not everyone identifies that genius, and people are scared because of fear of failure, fear of judgment, to run after their passion, to run after their genius. Once you identify that, Vahid, you and I both know when work and play become one, life gets really good.
It gets really good. That's a recipe for billions of dollars right there. That's the recipe. Listen.
And happiness. Happiness is
a lot of people look at Kobe's life and they're like, oh, it was unfortunate. I'm like, no, this guy lived 41 years of his life loving this. Like, I want that. I want the day that I die, I wanted to say at least 1 year of my life minimum, I did what I love to do and I got fulfillment out of it.
No question.
This guy loved it for 41 freaking years. He had better life than a lot of people living up to age of 100 and having a natural death. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
No question.
Thousands of people envy that. It was a little bit, tough. I mean, you got to understand that. You got a whole entire industry that's just driven on numbers, money, all of that, and then him making a passion, making money. But you could see that passion when you're your ankle is hurting and you're still playing. Your fingers are hurting, but you're still playing. You couldn't pay me enough money for me to shoot the ball with fingers that are hurting, are in pain. It's purely passion. Has no nothing pressure. To do with the money. Because he could have just sat out for that game and nothing would have happened to his money.
When he blew his Achilles, think about it. He came back in to shoot the free throws when he blew his Achilles, 3 or 4 years right before he retired. It was crazy. So no, it wasn't about money for him. It was never about money for him. It was about the love of the game and being able to pursue it and chase greatness to be the best he could possibly be. And he was chasing Jordan. He wanted to be like Jordan, and that as close as he could do it. And he was damn near close. Amazing. So yeah.
And I think Jordan even looked up to Kobe. I think at times Jordan, I mean, it wasn't like I'm better than you. This, it was like a mutual agreement. And you want to know something? The ladder on top is lonely.
Yeah.
Because only Kobe and Brian and those elite people understand truly what it takes to be part of that group. So when they see each other, they're like, hey, brother, what's up? That brother is not the same brother that you and I take, right? That's like, dude, I see you.
Yep.
I see what you've done and everything. Like, we have so much in common that you've done. It's on a different level.
It's like Malcolm Gladwell has a book called Outliers, and he talks about stories of success. And what you're talking about is true. There is a consistent thread. There's a nexus. There's something that's woven and connects all the great ones together. They all have it. And part of it is they hate losing more than they like winning. So they're literally willing to give up everything, including family time and what have you, to pursue that. And it comes at a cost. Listen, winning comes at a cost. Being successful comes at a cost. Leading comes at a cost. And it's lonely at all that. So you're right. When they see someone that's on that lane, it's like a fraternity that no one is in. I totally agree with that. So you're 100%
with that. I mean, I was reading a story and I was watching a documentary on people climbing Mount Everest. And I think like a couple of thousand people. I think the number was like 2,000 or something like that. Less than 3,000. Let's just, but don't quote me on that. Check it out for yourself. But let's just say less than 3,000 people on this planet out of the 7 billion people we have have been able to accomplish that. Yeah. That's a very tight niche group and club. That's like a mastermind group to like the next level. These people all saw death in their – they saw it. Yep. Multiple times, that is no joke, because when you walk inside that room, they have experienced something mutually. They're like brothers and sisters, even I think more closer than the blood brothers and sisters, because they experienced something on that level where only like that small group of people have experienced. So when they talk, I think they understand each other. Imagine you have that kind of mindset that you're going to go into your business and you're like, you know what, man? It's do or die. I'm not coming back. Like, either I'm going to make it, I'm going to die doing it. Like, having that kind of mindset, I don't think I even have it most of the time. But if you have it, man, that's why you got to be tough-skinned. Napoleon Hill talks about it. And I know you. So is there one of those geniuses that you're hard-headed? You're just going to go do it no matter what? Is there a genius in that?
Yeah, so it's not necessary. I think that's a trait within some of the geniuses, but it's not one genius that actually maps to. I think athletic genius, musical genius, visual genius, social genius, and tech genius, those are the ones that stand out as the top five when I look at it, because everyone loves music. A lot of people love athletics. A lot of people love technology. Social makes sense, right? We're being social right now and communicating in social media. All those are really, really important. And the visual genes is everyone is very artistic and creative. So within that, you have people that are very driven and there are different levels to their drive, but they're all chasing greatness. I think that's what you're talking about. That's a character trait for people that just want to be the best.
My question is, why schools don't teach that? None of my teachers ever told me to stick to it like a glue and don't let go. Unless there's a tsunami that comes down, unless someone puts a gun to your head, like, don't move. This is it. This is your business. You're going to do or die. You're going to make it. Like, why are they not teaching that in school? I mean, you got a lot of experience because you speak at a lot of these schools and you deal with these teachers, superintendent, deans, vice president, all of these different people, right? So why none of my teachers ever said, did I go to wrong school?
No. It's, you didn't go to the wrong school. The problem with the current educational system is that it doesn't teach, in my opinion, the skills that really map to success in life. Think about it. Half the stuff you learn in school, you don't use in the day-to-day. It's insanity. It makes no sense. So it's not that you went to the wrong school. It's that the system is flawed. Part of the reason, when I go and speak, I do keynotes and workshops. I'm part of a speakers bureau in California and part of CATA. CATA is the California Association of Directors and Activities. And each high school, middle school has a department that's dedicated to student success and empowerment, which is called ASB, Associated Student Body. So when I go and speak, I'm there to inspire and motivate the kids, but I also use my platform as a living example of someone that's making their passion their paycheck and inspiring them to go chase their dreams by focusing what they're passionate about and monetizing that. So it's not being taught because the way the system is set up, that's what I'm trying to change with my course and my platform, because I think it's flawed. It is setting kids up for, they're not set up for success. Because think about it. If you're focusing on an industry that you don't love and you're not passionate about, how would you be successful at it? And you're not going to be happy. It just won't work, right? It's actually quite silly.
That's why you got the highest ratio of divorce, suicide, highest ratio of drug abuse among doctors, engineers, lawyers. Yeah. I mean, attorneys have the highest rate of substance abuse.
That's correct.
These are intelligent, high IQ people. They know alcohol and drugs is not good for them. They know that, right? Yeah. But why are they still doing it? Why are they still abusing it?
Because
and during the process, you're hurting other people too. It's not just yourself. I'm okay with you going doing whatever you want to do to your body. Your control of it. You go do whatever you need to do. I'm cool. But then you're hurting your family, loved ones, people that are around you also too.
Nonsense. And the short answer to that, they're doing it because they're unhappy. That's why. It's very simple.
No fulfillment.
So, it's just that simple.
Torrance, if I give you an option today, I said, Torrance, if you do this job for me, I'm going to pay you $500,000, but you don't love it. You're not passionate about it. Uh-huh. But I'm going to give you this other position, this other business. You make $150,000, but you'll be fulfilled.
Yep.
What would your decision, which one would you take?
I'm taking the 150, period. No question. That's not.
But that's $350,000. That's a lot of money. We're talking about $20,000 to $28,000 difference per month.
Doesn't matter. Here's why.
Your wife would be much happier. Your kids will be much happier. A lot of your mom and dad are going to be more comfortable in retirement. All of that benefit.
No, here's why. The money will come and go. It ebbs and flows. My happiness, my intrinsic happiness, my ability to wake up every day and love. When I wake up right now, I'm hitting the floor. I'm putting my jersey on. I'm ready to go. That ain't about money. It's about my own personal fulfillment. I feel like I'm making a difference in the world. I'm having significance. That ain't got nothing to do with money, period. So and here's the thing. Here's what people don't realize. If you're patient enough, the money will come. And then when the money comes and I'm happy, now I'm winning. Period. So no, you should never do something solely for money, ever. And I get we need money to live, no question, right? It's important. But if you're making a decision solely for money, that typically is a bad choice. You should never do that, in my opinion. So,
and because of this pandemic, we just realized that people could live on $15,000, $20,000 per year. We just realized. Live off of $15,000, $20,000 because your car ain't going to do shit for you if it's sitting in the driveway. Like, you're not going anywhere. So you could survive with $15,000, $20,000. You know, you pay a little bit of rent, a little bit of food. You could be happy, stay home. I just got a taste of maybe retirement for like 2-3 days. Well, I was like, let me see what's going on. There's this, watching news, all that for 2-3 days. And I'm like, I don't like this.
No.
This is not for some people like it. I miss going. I just kept making excuses to come to the office. I just kept making it too. I was like, look, I'm going there to check the computer. My wife's like, why do you need to check the computers? I'm like, let me just go see if the power is on. I gotta go check the mailbox. She's like, all the bills are electronic. Why are you going to check the door? I'm like, let me just go to the office. I just want to go to the office.
No, I just want to go to the office. No. Yeah, that's
why. I'm over here by myself alone.
That's funny. I get it. I totally get it. And I understand that. But here's the thing, Vahid. For you and I, we're very passionate about what we do. And we here's the thing. We're very blessed to be have identified a career and a profession and a calling that we now can monetize that we love to do. That's a blessing. That's a tremendous blessing. So you going to check the computer, it's less about that. It's more about you just getting back into your normal day-to-day flow and getting out of the house for a little bit, right?
So, that's it. Totally fine. So, Torrance, where people can find you?
Yeah, so you can find me on Instagram at Torrance Hampton, the number one. So T-O-R-R-A-N-C-E, Hampton, H-A-M-P-T-O-N, the number one. Or you can also hit my website, which is the Genius Factor Academy. So geniusfactor.teachable.com. So geniusfactor.teachable.com. That give you all the information on Make Your Passion Your Paycheck, the movement, the course, where I'm speaking, all the stuff that I got going on right now.
Listen, man, I'm not done with you. We're going to do a lot of good stuff together. I'm excited. A lot of good things are about to happen. I'm waiting for this COVID-19 to just go so we could just spread our wing and just start flying.
No question.
This thing just reset everything. Listen, if it wasn't because of COVID-19, you and I would have not met.
That is true. That is true. So I'm grateful that we did get a chance to be. It's the beginning of you and I doing a lot of business together. And let me also say, Vahid, I really, really admire the platform that you've created. I absolutely admire the Napoleon Hill mindset of thinking grow rich and what those tenets, those principles are, I think, mapped to creating wealth, which is really important. And notice I said wealth, not riches. There's a difference, right?
There's a big difference.
Big difference. Kudos to you in building that community, but also taking time to educate others on how they should be thinking about creating wealth and legacy. That's really important for me. I know you're a family man, you have kids. It's about leaving a legacy to our kids' kids. You can't do that if you're not, number one, getting and creating assets and then monetizing those and creating revenue streams that are residual, period, passive income. If you're not doing that, you can't create wealth. You definitely can't leave a legacy if you're broke. So
thank you so much. I appreciate it. You and I are going to do a lot of good stuff, especially with the school system, because I'm very passionate. I wish, you know, that somebody, you know, would have came to our high school and done that. I went to a school where there was like so much drugs. We had two cops on the premises all the time. I saw people getting arrested all the time. I was part of the Magnet Pro. But beside that, there is a lot more improvement and change that could be done for our future. And I want my kids to one day grow up, the day that I'm not here, say, you know what? He did a lot of things wrong. He could have done a lot of things. But you know what? These two, three areas, he went after it and he made an impact. And that's all I wanted to know. And here's a bunch of money for you to carry on the legacy. So you and I are going to be in contact. We're going to do a lot of great things, brother. I appreciate you being here. Thank you so much.
Much love. We'll talk soon. All right.
Talk to you soon. Right. Bye-bye.